Rajeev is an architect. He set up the incredible Studio X Mumbai, which is a very exciting place. And he'll tell us about that. Archana is someone whom I met some years ago in Bangalore. I met Sean first, who's now her husband, at a TED conference. We were both fellows. And then I got to visit them often and actually be part of their beautiful ecosystem that they've set up in Bangalore, where technology, art, social entrepreneurship, the crafts, all kind of mingle together in this beautiful hackerspace environment, one of the manifestations of which is Jaaga. And Navroze, I have the pleasure of working with every day in Hubble, at the Innovation Center and beyond, as we are transforming Godrej into this open source kind of corporation where ideas can flow beautifully both within and outside as well. So you all are all friends. It's my pleasure to welcome you here. And let's have an interesting and exciting conversation. So if I can ask Archana to please come up and share her her project, which is Jaaga, with us first. Archana.
Sure. Thanks, all of you, for having me over. I'm really excited to be in this absolutely fantastic space. And space has really been a big part of my life the last few years, specifically for the last 5 years. Jaaga actually means space in Kannada, and for those of you who speak Hindi, also means awakened, which is kind of a happy, you know, happy thing for us. Today I'm going to talk briefly about the iterations of our play with space in Bangalore, three versions of this, and some of the learnings from that, and kind of speculate on what we might want to tinker with in the future for version 4. Our tagline when we started was create a common ground. My partner had a very successful exit from the Silicon Valley. He's a technologist with an inclination towards arts and design, his mother being an artist. And I spent a fair amount of time at Microsoft Research India, so hung out with some of the leading minds in the tech space, but grew up and spent several years in the art and design space, both educationally and otherwise. So it was a happy coincidence that we both met. And over a couple of conversations and lots of beer, we figured that it would be fascinating to bring together our communities into some kind of a safe, unexpected place. And that was how we started. There was no vision, no mission, no goal, no anything beyond of, let's play, let's find some underutilized land, and then use something as innocuous as pallet racks. So pallet racks are basically shelving material. Large warehouses will use this, and they're made out of steel, and kind of reminded us of like playing with Legos, like kids play with Legos. So it's very modular, and it's easy to build. So we called it a community art architecture experiment and invited our communities to come and join us, starting with paper models and then, you know, moving on to actually constructing a fairly large building. We included artists and designers and invited them to think about using this structure, multi-storied structure, to think about things like vertical gardens using hydroponics as a reaction to some of the water crises that most of our urban cities in India, definitely Bangalore given its altitude, to pump up water. So, you know, what does it look like if we have a circulatory hydroponic system with vertical gardens? This is our experiment with that. What happens if you use urban waste and create large murals? So, you know, endless, ceaseless kind of invitations, and the community absorbed us as well. So we had, you know, tons of dancers exploring the space with their bodies, exhibitions, Shishti School of Design with their graduation shows, film festivals, you guys get the idea. It started to become much more than a 6 month experiment. It started to become an organization of its own, purely on the will of the people. So about a year in, we formed the Jaaga Trust, a public charitable trust, And we decided that we've got to help continue and sustain this kind of energy in the city. Like I said, my partner, when he came in, he had been, just before that, had been working with IIM in Ahmedabad and ran the AI Accelerator program there and brought a small bunch of them over. So you can imagine this really avant-garde space with a kind of a core group of basically startups, young startups, sitting there working really hard while the artists and designers and social activists kind of buzzed around them in this flurry of creative energy. And that's what we realized. We had become a community space and a very shared space. Everyone felt ownership of it because they were part of designing and building it. The interdisciplinary learnings were easily shared across the group, so cross-pollination, definitely. And in the process, we realized that there was a, you know, they were becoming activated citizens, which was extremely crucial at that time. This is 2009, 2010. So this is what I had, like an early presentation, I found this and I said, this is what we were thinking. So actually Jaaga means not just space, it's space and the people. That's what is interesting about it, right? Now version two, we were squatting on this piece of land. Mr. Naresh Narasimhan, a fairly famous architect, had lent us this piece of land, and he's like, okay, Archana, you know, you said you were going to stay for 3 or 4 months. It's been 18 months now. Yeah, kind of got to move on. You promised this was going to be nomadic. So I was like, all right, let's look for a new space. But this time, we've watched people over 18 months. We've watched how they've used the space and transformed it each time to suit their needs, to suit their users. What if we now tried an experiment where we use the same Palatrack system, but like really provide dedicated spaces for the kinds of activities that Jaaga had started to support. So we packed up, and you can see we're wrapping up the building, found a gorgeous, large piece of land covered with about 4.5-5 feet of urban waste, which was great for us. It meant we had to clean a lot, but it also meant we got a lot of stuff from the rummaging of that space, right? And then we started to construct and build, but this time with dedicated areas. So we had like auditoriums, we had a workshop area, we had specific areas for our co-workers to sit and work slightly undisturbed, a gorgeous cafe, affordable for our hungry, starving artists and technologists. So it was all that. So I'm gonna let you watch this short video. Freeman Marie and I started Jaaga in 2009. It's a not-for-profit and it supports artists, activists, designers and technologists to come together, share their work with each other and with the public.
We call it the Living Building. Here at Jaaga we're using pallet racks, which are warehouse shelving and relatively easy to assemble and deconstruct. And this is all in keeping with our mission at Jaaga to stay nomadic. Ultimately, it is an exploration into low-cost, high-density, sustainable living.
Jaaga now has 4 main programs: Jaaga Community, Jaaga Startup, Jaaga Study, and Jaaga DNA.
Through our community program, on average, we support more than 30 public service events in a month in Audi, Rooftop, Commons, and Mathart. Info at Jaaga.in receives around 600 inquiries a month from people who are interested to get connected to Jaaga.
I've just graduated from an engineering college and I'm excited to see how online classes can be made more accessible through the Jaaga study program.
What we're really hoping we can explore and really pioneer is kind of this blended learning model where we use the online resources to the fullest extent possible, but then also look at how we can provide both physical space and real human interaction in the form of peers, coaches, and experts that will help make this experience as productive as possible for. for the students.
Jaaga DNA celebrates applying design thinking. What happens when design plays with art, when design process meets technology, when design teams up with activism. Our projects are very much grounded in research, community dialogue, workshopping, and of course, lots of experimentation.
Jaaga Startup is our incubator program. Here we enable people with very nascent ideas to slowly build out their tech or design startups. Annually, we take them on a roadshow where we showcase the best of these young companies to investors and friendly supporters in the States. Jaaga supports a diverse group of hackers and makers through our project-based internships and residencies.
And Archana and the team here at Jaaga help me with the cultural understanding, the business aspects, the financial aspects, and the technicalities of writing and publishing a book. I love all things print. And I came to Jaaga with the idea of working with print and setting up something. So we built almost from scratch a screen printing space. And the intention was to make it accessible to the public, and people are interested to know more and use screen printing. Yeah, Jaaga loves printing, so we'll see you here.
We're a great team on a fantastical pirate ship, grand vision for our future. And we look forward to have you join, participate, and support us. We made this last year, actually. I was about 7 months pregnant, I think, at that time. Almost 3 months after that, in December, we moved. We made this crazy decision, influenced by the people who you met here, of like, you know what, we need to take this to the next level. What does that next level look like? Some of these things we already heard. We were an extremely activated space. What we really felt was, great, we've managed to create this core of creative energy. We've managed to magnetically invite some of the sharpest, brightest, most caring people. But they need more support. They need program support. So beyond of just space, now we have space and people, but we needed some more, you know, to take them, to help them go to the next level. Might have had something to do with the fact that, you know, becoming a mom made me start to think about, okay, you know, I need to move out of the sandbox and into the next phase for Jaaga as well. So that word sustainable, not just ecologically, but also financially, started to play a role. So this is the next one, Jaaga, a space, people and programs for the people. So today, in January, we launched our study program as a pilot, a one-year pilot. It's a MOOC campus, blended learning, flipped classroom, and leveraging this kind of teacherless space. We have about 25 students who've signed up. We had more than 300 applicants and screened them closely. And it's on a gorgeous, gorgeous banana plantation, about 6.5 acres, just on the very peripheral of this rapidly growing city. We moved. You can see here, it's absolutely beautiful. Our students are anyone from like a college dropout to a guy who's worked 10 years in industry to, you know, someone who studied commerce. All of them have the intention of joining the IT revolution one way or another. They want to train themselves to have the skills that they need to be desirable for industry. And clearly they work hard. The Jaaga DNA program looks at design networks and arts. Currently, we're running two major things. One is the Hampi Crafts Project, working with the government of India, documenting people and processes. And the other is the Investment Zone Project. You'll see some pictures. The first one we did was the Urban Avant-Garde, which was 2 years ago. and it was a urban rehabilitation program of an old neighborhood using art and design and processes in urban space, inviting graffiti artists from Europe, specifically Germany, and to work with Indian artists, right? So this is the Hampi Crafts project. We're trying to capture a segment of what is going on in Hampi region today and trying to digitize that. Making it available to more and more people online. And Investment Zone is a fantastic little experiment under a flyover for 6 months, 10 artists and 10 of their collaborators. So 20 artists, designers, urban planners hang out under this flyover till December, trying to rehabilitate the space, engage community, and do something amazing. And Jaaga Startup is now with 47 members, 20 of whom are founders. We have a fancy penthouse in the very center of town, and we thought our people needed to be able to call in their investors, their clients, and play the game, you know, on their own turf. So it's all cool to live in a, you know, avant-garde building, but you also need a professional space. So this is how we look now in their beautiful offices, shared working spaces. Lots of people, lots of talks, lots of workshops, lots of presentations, but this time focused on the needs, learning needs, growing needs of our members. And that's where we are now. And these pilots will play themselves out by December. I hope to publish online at least, if nothing else. And what we look for now is for partners to make our programs more succinct, more wonderful. And that's pretty much all I have for you guys today. We changed our tagline. Now we're programs and space for creative people.
So if I can now ask Rajeev to come up and share your Studio X Mumbai story with us.
The architecture of collaboration. It's probably what I've been doing now for the last 4 years or 5 years. Besides being an architect and practicing, I have to say this is the most interesting part of my career, at least up till now. Hopefully there are many more years of something more coming. So this is me before the collaboration space. I was alone, independent, lonely. Yes, you're with your ideas, which is great, but you need something more. So here comes Columbia University with this concept of Studio X. And they approached me about 4.5 years ago saying they wanted to create a collaborative space which focused on the future of cities. And what does that mean, the future of cities? Well, at first I thought it was urban planning, because Bombay needs good urban planning, it needs good design. And then slowly through the process, I realized it's not just about me looking at urban planning or looking at urban design or architecture in Mumbai, it's about creating a network, a system of collaborations over not only Mumbai, but other cities. And like I said, Columbia University's here in New York, but we have spaces in Santiago, São Paulo, Rio, Paris, Moscow. Well, Moscow is not open yet, but Istanbul, Amman, Johannesburg, Tokyo, Beijing. We did a pop-up at the Biennale in Shenzhen. And of course, we have Mumbai. And it is truly a network. And I think collaboration also talks about networks. It's not about individuals. It's about the kind of individuals coming together and making that that kind of interesting, dynamic, diverse space. So what do you do with a collaborative space? This is the kind of initial question. What do we do? Of course, you have to have a lot of cool things. I think Parmesh also has set up a lot of cool things here. The coffee bar is fantastic. We still are looking for that. We don't have funding for that. So if anybody can help us with that, it would be great. You have a book gallery. You have a global interface. You have a lecture space, a workspace, you have a space to think, to ideate. You have, of course, meeting rooms and offices. So a collaborative space is not just, even if it comes from academic institution, it can't just be academic. It has to somehow integrate itself. It has to somehow fit in. And I always make the reference to the fact that it has to kind of have a camouflage effect to it. So sometimes it's professional, and sometimes it's just down and dirty and something else. And that's what we've been trying to do with Studio X. And I think anybody who's, maybe some of you know the space, I know some, I see some familiar space faces. We can never be labeled as one thing, which I'm very happy about. It's not a space for just architecture. It's a space for art, architecture. It's a space for just ideas to come out in any form is, and the knowledge that comes with that. So there's a series of different programs that we work with. I cut it down to, I want to present four of them today. Mostly the projects that have to do with collaboration. So we have, the first one is called Unprepared. This is one of the first projects we did in 2011. This was a project which was brought to us by Droog Design in Amsterdam. They came to us and they spoke to us about this research project that they do every year, where they focus on a different city. And this year, at that time, they were focusing on Mumbai, and they said, what can we do? And I said, well, we should do something with design, but we should question what design is, because you guys think you know what design is. In Amsterdam, it looks all beautiful, but what does design really mean here? And they said that was a great idea, so why don't we do something on design? So we started to talk, and we had people come in from all over the world, including Bas Prinsen, who's an amazing photographer of landscapes and architecture. We had product designers from Delhi, we had the Droog design team, Renny Ramakers and Agata Jaworski from Droog, and we just put this question out: what is the future of design? Now, how do you answer a question like that in Mumbai? It's very difficult. And through kind of thinking about it and thinking about the process, we said, well, you know what? All of our knowledge is not going to help here. What we need to do is pick something that nobody knows anything about and throw it into the system and then see what knowledge comes back to us. So what we did was, we went out there and we looked. And we looked in all the weirdest places. We went to BKC, we went to subways in Siam, we went to playing fields where they're playing cricket, and we just looked for clues to what design was. And we didn't find anything. So we were looking in some books, and Boss just came to me and said, you know, I found this diagram. And I was like, what is it? And he's like, I don't know. And then we looked it up, and we finally found that it's this famous mathematician's diagram. And he said, does anybody know anything about this diagram? And everyone said, no. He said, great, this is what we're going to start with. So we started with it, we drew it up, and then we just threw it out into the system. So we took it to Dharavi, and we went to vendors in Dharavi who were doing different things, kite makers, sock makers, people who are making bhajiyas, all kinds of things, all the recycling areas, and we gave them this diagram and said, we're coming back in 3 days, do something with it. Now, everyone thought we were absolutely mad. But what we realized was the interesting thing, that they did start to make stuff. They started to kind of, people who make bags, they started to kind of think about that diagram and say, okay, it has to be three-dimensional for us, so let's make something three-dimensional. You had people who were doing metal boxes, so they made like, storage units that were this shape. Printmakers were making shirts. Other people were making drawings here. So a lot of interesting thing was happening, but we still didn't know what you were going to do with it. We went to a recycling guy who recycles all the plastics and the papers. He started to put something together as an idea diagram, and then he made this little metal box there. We went to a kite maker, which was the most fun because he was trying to figure out how this thing would fly. He really wanted to fly it. This was in January, so this was right at the time when he could have made big bucks on that. And then finally what we did was we had a big shindig at Studio X, and we invited all the people who were obviously involved. We had sociologists, we also had herbs. I don't know if you guys know who herbs is, sociologists that work in Dharavi. They were also on the team. So they were there, they discussed the ideas about the kind of intricacies of what that question means to people in this type of context and scenario. And we came up with lots of interesting things. Of course, there were the photographs and all, but there was this a beautiful exhibition in which the people from Dharavi who actually produced the projects, they came. You know, they came with the sock that was about, you know, 3 meters long, and they made up that diagram, and they were very happy to present it in a space like Studio X. So this is this one. This is actually a sock, which is about, like I said, three meters long. So that was one project. Another one we did more specifically and more focused was with an artist named Swazik Gwezenek. She's a French artist based in Mumbai. And she came to me with this interesting idea of setting up a real estate office. And she's an artist, so she's like, I'm not going to really sell anything, but I want to sell ideas on how nature and the city kind of react to each other. So we said, okay, do you want to do an exhibition, this and that? She's like, I want to do an exhibition, and I've done all these works. And I said, okay, great, but why don't we actually make the office? Why don't we set up an office where you set brochures, you invite people, and you sell them these ideas? It's not necessarily real estate, but it's an idea for how they could use that within the city. So it was called Happy Owners, and the name of the real estate was Subjective Architecture Realty, which is this. And it was done in collaboration with Studio X and the Alliance Française de Bombay. She did a series of videos and kind of artworks also that looked at all the kind of problems we see every day in a city like Mumbai and what affects us, whether it's waterlogging and rain, whether it's the slums, whether it's flooding. It could be just the idea of also development, rampant development, flouting of rules, nature, anything. These are some of the projects she worked on. And she did works on top of existing photographs, which she takes around the city. So Cascade Grandeur, Magic Mushrooms was one of my favorites. And she did a website where people could log in and they could actually email us with inquiries on how to get these spaces. And I can't, I'm very serious. There were many people asking where I can get like a flat or an office space in Magic Mushrooms. And it was impossible to explain to them that this was an idea, you know, this was an idea. We did a series of installations in the space that was also based on kind of collaboration, which Swazik was fantastic, but she also needed an architect or she needed somebody who thinks about space in a different way. So we did some interesting installations. This was the exhibition at the space. These are some of her personal sketches and paintings that she did. We did a series of workshops with students, also young students, and asked them to kind of draw what they feel the city should be. Not only what they see around them, but what would they like to see. So we had some fantastic images of what they came up with. We also had a large map, which we printed, and we allowed the kids also to play a game. And there were basically soldiers of green, which represented nature, and then there were soldiers of gray, which represented development. And they were talking about what kind of organizations they would want to see. So it was a kind of fantastic way of just re-envisioning and re-ideating on an idea that we see every day in the papers, and we probably just pass the articles and say, okay, you know, it's not my problem, I can't do anything about it. But yes, we can, just through thinking also. This was a project that I worked on with another artist, but we did this in a public space. This was outside the gallery. This wasn't about kind of being in the hermetic space of Studio X, but kind of going out and seeing what can be done outside. This was done in conjunction with the BMW Guggenheim Lab. And the idea was to create this question around privacy. What is privacy and what's public space in a city like Mumbai? And you know, it's very easy to kind of go out there and go to a main space and ask people questions and all, and you kind of get these answers. But we said that we don't want to do that. If we go out there and with a questionnaire asking people what's there, we're not going to get that kind of honest response, you know? So what we said was, let's create a very private space, which was this thing that looks like a bunch of bamboos that are just standing up, in a big public space that's totally chaotic. And the idea here was, looking at Mahim Beach, we saw all these, that's where all the bamboo wallas have their shops and everything. So we said, you know, the idea is to kind of camouflage within that bamboo walla type of idea, and let's just put a bunch of bamboos, but let people access that space and do something with it. So this is them putting up the bamboo structure, and this is what we came out with the end, and we lit it at night, which was interesting. But the idea, main idea was that we had a we had a terminal inside which people could type in their responses to certain questions, and then the answers would be displayed outside of that interior space. So someone who was sitting outside was actually having some type of communication with the person inside the bamboo structure. And it was interesting because it was all live, so whatever people were asking, that information was kind of coming out. So it was having like a chat, like a whatever you have, like a live chat with someone, but the person is literally 2 feet away from you, they can't see you. This is actually pretty interesting because we got a good series of answers to some of the questions. These were the questions we put out. And these are some of the straight answers. These are unedited, you know? Which I thought was pretty fair. I didn't want to, make it something more than it was. This is the last project I'm going to present. This was called Knowledge City. This was done as a collaboration in conjunction with Columbia University's Graduate School of Architecture, one of the studios, and NMIMS, the Balwant State School of Architecture here in Mumbai. We got the two studios together to think about a project for public space and to also look at architecture and design. I mean, this is a much more kind of straightforward project, but it dealt with a collaboration that had started in New York and basically happened over the internet for a period of 2-3 weeks in terms of exchanging ideas and projects, and then eventually coming to Mumbai and building it. So we took a site at Bandra's Carter Road, which we thought was fantastic because it has people jogging, it has fisherman's village very close by, it has a lot of kids, people walking dogs, it's got a great residential vibe to it, it's got people hanging out till 4-5 in the morning. We picked that site. And the project was slowly developed in New York as an idea for some kind of a sculptural piece. Then there was a series of kind of, you know, workshops and kind of meetings between the students from New York and the students in Mumbai on how we're going to put this thing together, what is it going to be made of, how do we do the digital files, how do we get it fabricated. And then all the stuff was kind of fabricated and then moved to site. And we spent basically 2.5-3 days on site up till, I mean, we were there at 4:35 in the morning. Some of the students, one is right there. I mean, totally crazy, having chai, finding a chai wala at 4 in the morning, you know, is quite difficult. Little kids from the neighborhood coming and helping us at 3 in the morning. 8-year-olds, I mean, it was quite fantastic. So we did the mock-ups, we did a bunch of also praying. We were praying a lot that this thing would stand up. You see all the kind of debris here. A lot of frustration, but then this is eventually what happened. We did this very interesting kind of architectural structure, and we said, okay, now what's going to happen? What are people going to do there? It sits in this landscape between the sea and the buildings there. And then we just opened it up at night, and we said, okay, who's going to come and see this thing? But everybody came, which was fantastic. And the kids loved it the most. This is the last thing I'm going to show tonight, but the idea of the collaboration didn't just end with two groups of architecture students sitting in a room and making something. The collaboration ended in a public event. It ended as part of integrated into the space of the city, and I think that was the success of the project. Thank you.
Thank you. Our third speaker this evening is trying to create a collaborative workspace within the corporate world. And Navroze, if you're ready, tell us about the Hubble, which is where we're all actually sitting, and which afterwards over snacks, I invite you to all walk over and explore.
Thanks. Welcome, everyone. Welcome to Hubble. So this is what work looks like inside most companies. It's uninspiring, it's really dull, and the problem is that it prevents people from really stretching themselves and going beyond just the task that that's in front of them and what's required of them. It closes people off instead of setting them free. If you were here about a year ago, that's what this space looked like. It was leased out to an IT company, and it looked quite similar to this. But now you're here. You're at Hubble, which is sort of Godrej's attempt to break away from this cubicle culture and present a totally new idea for what the future of work can be. It's a prototype workspace, and it's our way of sort of standing in the future, if you will, and saying, this is how we want to work, and this is what we believe the future of work could look like, and this is the kind of culture that we all want to live in. So I'm going to quickly present our hypotheses. Most organizations, the way that they organize themselves, right? So they're split into business units, they're split into functions, like there's a marketing team, there's a design team, there's an engineering team, and we organize ourselves vertically that way. In addition to that, what organizations do is that they have levels, they have hierarchies. Right? They have junior people when they come into the company. As they progress, they move higher and higher in hierarchies. And what that does is that it literally chops organizations into boxes. And the way most organizations design their systems, their processes, is to make each of these boxes really efficient. So what does product A in marketing need? Or what does product B in design need? What does someone who's recently just entering a company in a business, what do they need? And we design all our systems and processes to make each of these highly efficient and really successful. And what happens is that we forget about what happens between these, what happens to these relationships. And so we design for nodes as opposed to designing for relationships. And our hypothesis is that it's these relationships that are much more important than these individual nodes. And it's if you design for these relationships and design for movement across these different nodes, that's what leads to the best ideas, and that's what allows people to move beyond just what's in front of them and enables them to reach out and look beyond just their job and have a much more holistic point of view on their work and on the world. So this is what happens over time. Organizations chop themselves into boxes, and we design all our systems to make each of these nodes highly, highly efficient. And this way of structuring companies into these individual nodes, I think it makes teams very inward-looking. They only look at the task in front of them and they forget the holistic points of view that organizations need them to think about. I think this is even true for companies. Companies think of themselves as individual entities, and companies exist in isolation of each other. But people don't exist in isolation of each other. The way we live is not from industry to industry or market segment to market segment. And there's industries are converging, technologies are converging, and companies across industries need to work much more with each other. People are interconnected, and companies need to leverage that interconnectedness in order to truly satisfy the needs that people have. So when designing Hubble, a lot of these ideas influenced how we thought about conceptualizing this space. And a lot of the discussions sort of centered around what kind of culture do we want to create? And what kind of organization? Well, how open do we want to be as a culture and as a company? And it became clear that Hubble really did have to be this open space and embody the way that we were thinking about the kind of company that we want to be. It had to encourage these informal networks to form. It had to enable relationships to get built across hierarchies and across industries and sort of business verticals. And it had to support high levels of productivity and performance, because when you open it up and enable people to move in a much freer way across just their own job or their own task, you have to also provide structure at the same time, structure that enables people to be productive. So it doesn't get rid of the organization of businesses and specializations, but it's opening people's minds. So the question became, how can we really design a space that's going to help people achieve their full potential? And how can we bring about this cultural change and sort of live in the future a little? The space is designed around a central platform. The idea of the platform is that it's a place to share, to reach out and you know, meet someone new, start a conversation. So it's very open. It's also giving people a way to be really productive. So for teams or individuals that need focus time, it's giving it's allowing that time when you need to be really focused on what you need to do or your project work, when you need to retreat a little bit not be a part of the sort of craziness around you. That's important too. You know, that needs to be designed, a place to retreat and reflect. There's food and there's fun. People need to. I think the plantation idea is fabulous, but this is our way of saying that. Yes, you do need that that space to let go a little bit, and sometimes having this as an option also really it does enable people to be more productive, and it's designed for different kinds of work, so small team spaces, individual workspaces, and larger team spaces. So it's essentially designed as a workspace that can support a lot of this. This space, of course, the philosophy, I think it spreads beyond Hubble. We have an innovation center just across from there, which does a lot of project work and thinking about, sort of the future the businesses and the industries that we operate in as a group. And so it's an idea that we're using really to design the way that we work. And where people are more empowered, teams have the infrastructure to to think creatively. And I think space is not the only way, but it's definitely one way where you can empower teams to feel like they're allowed to explore and think beyond just what's in front of them. So it's also a space where we need to turn ideas into businesses. And what we're trying to do is encourage much more experimentation and prototyping, and doing that through a continuous sort of process of developing ideas, trying something out really quickly. We've got a prototype shop that's sort of a very sort of maker space kind of environment, and that's another platform that's open, and people can leverage the facilities that are available over there as well. So the organization becomes the platform for people to do their best work. It's not about employees and employers. It's not about the most senior person in the room taking decisions, but it's about creating a healthy environment where you can critique each other and with the objective of moving everyone's collective thinking and ideas forward. So, on a more personal note, I think the space itself is, I think, a really great example of collaboration, because we brought everyone, we brought designers, we brought our teams from across the company together to conceptualize the space. We designed everything internally. We had designers collaborate, and not a small number of them initially, but it was the spirit of collaboration and coming up with something that's really strong that created a sort of a very homogeneous outcome. And we've got a lot of them sitting over here. We did things like go to our lock plant and look for scrap and, created interesting lights out of them. So did a lot of this sort of trying to engage multiple teams in the company across businesses and use that as a philosophy in to build the space as well. So I think it's a great example of collaboration as well. So just a few ideas to leave you with. So a company as a platform for people to do their best work. And what is the platform? It's a holistic experience only loosely controlled by the platform owner and supported by technology and typically characterized by integrated products and services provided through an ecosystem of partners, an ecosystem of collaborators. Creative empowerment, allowing people to stand in the future and sort of broaden their perspective and think very creatively. Giving people a broader sense of why they do what they do. I think companies that more and more people identify with companies that are purpose-driven, and people want to work. People want to work for companies that they can identify with. The idea over here is, if a company is a platform, then when you think about the kind of jobs that people, that companies create, you really have to, you know, design jobs and in a very different way. And it's almost like designing jobs for people, as opposed to thinking about, you know, people for jobs. You think about jobs for people, and what is the kind of work that's going to be meaningful for people? What is going to create that sort of shared purpose and understanding, and design work that can fulfill people's needs? Thanks.
Thank you. I'll open up to audience questions very quickly, but if before that I could just ask each one of these panelists, what was your biggest challenge in creating your respective collaborative workspace? If you want to have, was there one challenge or one constraint perhaps that you encountered and how you overcame it? Do you want to go first?
I'll go first.
Yeah.
You know, I'll go back like 50 years. If I go back 50, 55 years and I think about what's, collaboration is not a new thing, right? Okay? The fact that it's being focused on right now is just because we're going through a phase. There were great architecture and urban design artist platforms in the 60s, like Super Studio, and there was Archagram, and there's even in the 30s and the 40s and 50s, there were the Situationists. They were all artists, architects, urbanists, sociologists, product designers. I'm not talking about the Bauhaus. Forget about the Bauhaus. That was about making, necessarily. But this was about ideating on the space around us, right? So for me, the biggest challenge in a city like Mumbai, which requires spaces like this, because these are little, let's put it in your terms, they're boxes. They're still boxes. I mean, the fact that this is a space where we come to engage in this conversation, it's still a box. But when the idea kind of leaks out, right? Same thing with Studio X. We come to the space, many people come for a conversation or a lecture or a workshop, but then how does that idea get out? So I think the biggest obstacle for me is really engaging all the people that don't come to the space in one way or the other. You know, you can have a conversation with 50 people, 100 people, 150 on a great idea. You can hold an exhibition, how many people come? These are all questions. I mean, they're not things that, you know, I can solve overnight. It takes years and years for people to kind of rethink the way they engage their city. But I would like to say that all these spaces and all these ideas that we're talking about today, and whether in Bangalore or Bombay or anywhere around the world, you know, they are spaces for re-engaging the space outside of this box. They're not about just making little ideas and making cool things. They're about changing the what's around us. So I think that's the biggest challenge for me. And I think Studio X is still developing that and still looking for ways to kind of do it in a meaningful way. So.
Archana?
It's interesting. Things with Jaaga was so natural that I don't know exactly if there was any moment where I was like, oh my goodness, I don't know how to, you know? It was kind of like this hive mind, right? There were problems. We were off the grid for the first year. We didn't have electricity, we didn't have water. We had like a porta potty, that was our bathroom. And we had multiple events in the day. You know, and no one raised that. No one made complaints of it. So, you know, so I don't know. On a personal note, I think the worry I had every time I moved the location was, would that disrupt the energy that we have built? Would it move with us? Would it create a sense of loss? Can we, you know, can we, there's a notion of responsibility that I started to feel, which in the very beginning I didn't, I was playing with everyone else. But over time, over the, you know, now 5 years later, I feel like everyone there are my children in a weird way. Maybe it has something to do with being a mom. I don't know about that, but, you know. So for example, when the metro opened up its doors to the public and provided beautifully built auditoriums and gallery space in Bangalore on MG Road, which is like the main street, I was so relieved. You know, I was like, oh my goodness, I am so glad, because they put a fantastic program director there, someone who understands contemporary art, artists, you know, practices, processes, understands local culture and hyper-local culture. She's born and raised there, you know. So I felt like that was the challenge. Like, I felt like over time I had started to kind of feel like I held this sacred responsibility of all of that the people had given me somehow, of like, if I left, if I chose to like close the doors, for example, what happens, you know? And by the way, we are almost closed door on the campus in the farm, simply because we don't have the kind of funds to keep our doors wide open. We are closed door there, in the sense of like, once you make it in through our process of application, you're in, but there is a process. This was not the case for the last 4.5 years. Anyone, everyone was welcome to come and use and do, right? Now we have two spaces, and both of them have 3 steps of entry, which is a huge change from what Jaaga has been, you know, and that, I think, I don't know, complicated answer, but.
I think the biggest challenge was getting it ready on time. And then I think, very similar to what you're saying, I think understanding that that this is a prototype. We don't really know how people are going to use the space, but creating it in a way that's open enough and modular enough that people can kind of figure out for themselves how they want to use it, you know. So I think initially overcoming that, you know, are people going to perceive it as a workspace, or is it going to be more of a cafe? How is it going to get used? But I think by just putting it out there, it's you know, and then observing how people have been using it since it opened, has been a way to then say, okay, now how can we improve the space? If seeing how people are working, how can we make it more productive? But I think there weren't too many challenges, because I think everyone was aligned and sort of had a similar vision for what we wanted to achieve. So,
and then whatever comes out of it, and then, I mean, that's the surprise, right?
Yeah, and then the question was, how late should we keep it open? That was the other challenge.
And 24 hours?
Well, I thought people work 24 hours, but apparently not everyone does. We decided not.
And my question pertains to the privacy police project, which you did. I find it very interesting. So what makes you decide that you will do this experiment at Mahim Creek and not at a crowded Juhu beach, and what made you decide that it should be a structure of bamboos and not something else, maybe an empty bus? So one is about, is it just the physical proximity of bamboo wallas there that you decided to put up that structure? And secondly, when you engage in a live experiment like this, do you seek explicit permission from the authorities before putting it up, or do you face challenges or problems from cops coming and asking what is this all about and stuff like that?
The answers are very simple and they're not complicated. We were given the site. BMW had 5-6 sites in the city, and the site that was given to us was Mahim. We originally wanted it on the Bao Daji Lod campus,
but that was not possible, so we chose the Mahim site. And the idea was not to, unlike the last prototype installation that you saw, which was totally fabricated off of laser cutting, and it was pretty, I mean, it wasn't high tech, but it was high tech in a certain fashion. This was about going to the site and seeing what the site told us to do. You know, and thank God the bamboo was there, because the bamboo really, for me, it really, I mean, people actually thought it was a pile of bamboos that somebody has left there, you know, until they came up close to it and saw it. The permissions, we really didn't handle anything, but I'll tell you in all honesty, there was a cop station, there's a cop station there on Mahim Beach, on that site, and I used to stand under their, they have a little chajja, because it was so hot at that time. I used to stand there, and that the police guy was asking me, you know, what are you guys doing, and what is that computer for, and are you recording what we're doing? Because he was basically sitting there all day. I didn't see him get up, just literally moving. I said, no, I'm not recording you doing anything, or nothing, or whatever you're doing. I said, this is just a kind of experiment. And so then he said, so you're a scientist. I said, no, I'm not a scientist, I'm an architect. So why do you want to experiment? You know, this is the kind of, so actually my experiment was going outside of the box. This was, in a way, he was telling me the same things I was trying to find out in the installation, in a very nonchalant kind of conversation way. So, I mean, I think there's always a skepticism in a city like Mumbai. Anytime you do something out of the ordinary, like, you know, why are you doing that? And I think that is something that has to be inculcated in a culture. When people start to see those as things that you embrace, then you start to see urbanism, design, everything starting to flourish within the corporation and also in the public space. So hopefully I answered.
If I can extend that to both of you as well, why do you all do, in a broader level, why do you do what you do, and why do you choose specific kinds of collaborations over others?
Jaaga grew and became what it did, and I wasn't given a choice. It was decided by people, it was what they wanted, and I was caught up in that stream, you know. The projects, for example, the one that we're running now, Investment Zone, I actually wanted to select a space, so this is kind of like the public-private space project, right? Why are we working under a flyover in one of the busiest streets in the city? It is a harsh, harsh environment. I had to, I'm going to provide my artists masks and encourage them to wear earplugs. It's insane. I didn't choose it. I invited the artists in and then showed them multiple spaces, which included, you know, beautiful playground, the first property that Jaaga had with all of the amenities built in, and they chose, you know, under the flyover. And so I feel that there are times in the trajectory of a city where people want to do something, get activated to do something, and it's kind of a collective desire that starts to manifest, and I, being an artist and a designer, I feel the artists and designers kind of are the forerunners of that manifestation of thought, that, you know, and so they want, you know, so the people go there, and our artists go there and choose this harsh location because they feel that the city is crying, that people are crying for these spaces to be used, given that there is such a dearth for public space, you know? So, a convoluted response.
You don't choose. Navroze, what about you?
I think for me, it's a very simple answer. It's to ensure the success of the teams that I work with. It's to see other people succeed and to give people the right tools and environments, infrastructure, and consistent messaging in order for them to succeed. That is what an organization is, right? We spend such a big part of our lives inside, you know, the place that we work, and you know, that And we really need to ensure that people achieve their maximum potential. So seeing other people succeed is kind of why I do it. And I mean, as a company, you have that responsibility to address the needs of the environment around you as well, to see where you can have an impact on your immediate environment, and thinking broader on your country, right? Looking at what are the things that need to be done that you are in a position to affect, and that's why, and doing that through small experiments. You can't change everything all at once, but you can start in the periphery, right? You can start doing small experiments, and hopefully that has sort of a snowballing effect, and other people join you in that sort of common direction.
So Navroze, you've created a very beautiful space here. Have you measured any productivity gains for the people who work here?
Well, this space is now about 2 months old. It's probably leading to people thinking differently about their own workspace, which is kind of the objective. It's sort of to put the idea out in the world, and then, that has a ripple effect, a snowballing effect, and, other people pick up on it, and hopefully we'll see other spaces changing as well. And not just physical spaces, but sort of, mental spaces. Like, people are able to think in different ways, in more creative ways, I don't think that's too lofty a goal for a space like this, because it's really saying that this is what we can be, and then it's up to people. And I think that there are sponges, right? There are sponges, and there are places where ideas do get traction. So I'm pretty confident that it'll happen. In terms of productivity, I'm not sure how we measure the productiveness of the work that happens here, but I can say that it is leading to more sort of unshackled thinking. And that's difficult to quantify, and especially because it's early stages. But it is, I think it's doing its work as a collaborative space, right? Because it's broadening people's, lens of the way they see the world, and physically reaching out, but also mentally, and so.
If I can just add to that, I'll give you the example of the Culture Lab. When we started the Culture Lab 3 years ago, right? And now it's become quite established here in Vikhroli and in Bombay. Almost every week I get an email from someone across Godrej, either Ahmedabad or Delhi, or someone saying, why don't you bring Culture Lab to Delhi or Bombay? And I tell them that the Culture Lab is an idea. Why don't you do these things in Delhi or Bombay? I'm happy to come and set it up. And often they do, right? So a lot of times with things like this, it just gets emulated. And within, in our office, for example, we have a legal team now who started doing, we do Friday fundas, and they've been inspired, and they do legal fundas, for example. And that's great, right? So what we want to do is create these spaces as experimental spaces, and then let people kind of play with them.
Are those conversations happening, firstly? Right? Are those new kinds of conversations happening? Is, where otherwise they wouldn't happen, are people coming together, collaborating? Even if it's for an event, that's fine. If it's for a new idea or a new business, that's great as well. But I think, having a sense of, are those conversations happening?
My question is for Rajeev. I wanted to know, running a space like yours, where I mean, you've done many interesting activities over a period of, I think now, four years. Which one of them has been more of a learning experience for you, personally?
It's a difficult one because it's 4 years, but I would have to say the initial premise of opening up the space and kind of, you know, limiting my scope of knowledge to this architecture, urbanism, urban planning, design, which I thought it was going to focus on, and the fact of kind of then meeting filmmakers and meeting writers and musicians and having like all kinds of collaborations with a lot of the consulates and things like that. I mean, for me, I have found it challenging and invigorating to participate in any discussion that I have no knowledge of. Okay, and a lot of the stuff is I really have no knowledge of. I mean, I agree to participate and sit and ask questions or even give comments, but it's usually I have to pay a lot of attention. So that's why I was talking to Parmesh earlier, was that I think in the last 4 or 5 years out of my professional career, of all the things that I have done and different things I've done, this has been the most interesting. Because it's somewhere sits between being in school, which everyone, when they're in school, they want to get out. But when they're out, they want to go back. So I'm kind of sitting on this space in between. It's between profession, reality, practice, academics, and also connected to a whole circle of networks that I never knew existed. They just pop up at any one moment. And it can be just about this maker we were talking about before the talk, talking about making things. And I said, you know, we used to make things by, now everything's done on these 3D printers and things like that. And I remember making big models and pouring resin and, you know, cutting chipboard and casting POP. And this was my making at my time. And now if you ask me to make anything on a 3D printer, I really have no idea. So I told him, I'm going to take a class at your space because that's what I want to do. And he can host an event at Studio X because it's that exchange of knowledge that's going to enrich me. So that's the challenge. I can't say it's one event over the other.
You're still a student.
It's just the fact that you're put in this position of doing that. And then maybe the second thing, if I was going to say there's one more thing, is navigating the city. Navigating the city, trying to make connections to people that don't necessarily think in the same way, and trying to access that information and knowledge, I think that is the other challenge. So,
somewhere inside us, we all have a knack to scale up. And how do we trade off that? You know, I feel that scaling up is good and not good, I don't know. So basically, I have a perception, which I request you to challenge, that while we scale up, the essence of the initiative is getting faded away.
It's actually interesting what you brought up, because this has been a very big concern this last 6 months in particular. Scale, actually, Freeman and I spent a lot of time thinking about what scale meant for Jaaga. So I'm going to just answer what you said with like my personal experiences with Jaaga, right? What would happen if there was a Jaaga in every neighborhood, right? It's definitely something that we've thought about, definitely something like Parmesh was saying with the India Culture Lab. Over the years, we've got several requests from across the country. Can we have a Jaaga here? Can we have a Jaaga there? And so we really thought about that. You know, it feels like people want it. It is definitely one path to scale, multiply, you know, multiplicative. We spent like two, three weeks just brainstorming what that looked like. Would that help us keep the essence of the organization intact, you know? How we responded was interesting. We wrote down, you know, we did lots of exercises. Essentially, we both fought against it intuitively from our own from our own take, because I was like, that's great, we should do it. It sounds like the exact thing that we need to do because people are asking for it. I would like to step back a bit and, you know, focus on my kid. That was my thought, you know, and Freeman had a similar kind of like, that sounds great, I just want to go over to like a beautiful plantation and just hang out. And so our response to scale was, what is it that we most intrinsically want to do as a continuum, so scale in terms of continuum, to this project? I went in the direction of, I want to have a hold in the center of the city. I want it to be a professional space for emergent voices. And I want to be able to do my art practices, forays into the urban space as my interactions, you know, like keep our gates open through that process. For Freeman, it was, I want to take a bunch of kids that I carefully handpick and spend a year with them in a gorgeous farm. And that was our scale. That was scale to us, and the organization as what it is today is Freeman and me and all of the people that we are hoping to support and help, playing maybe a small role in their success, hopefully, right? And it's a very worrying thing because, yes, we have closed our doors and now we do charge for 5 years, 4.5 years, we were entirely free for people to work. The last 6 months we started to charge nominally and now we charge, I would say, reasonably, you know? And these were very carefully, like, nervously taken steps, right? But just what felt okay to us.
Well, I love that idea. I think small is beautiful too, right? And because, like, I mean, yes, I think people's sort of natural ambition is to want to, when something works, is to grow it. But I think maybe a different way to think about scaling is, instead of scaling, physical spaces, like, you know, having a Jaaga on every street corner, it's scaling of the ideas and scaling of, you know, what is that? Giving people the tools, giving people, you know, the ideas and putting those out there. And, you know, I think that's a different way that maybe you can think about scale.
Rajeev, do you want to add or tell us about how with Studio X, maybe these other locations, because with Studio X, it's scaling with, you know, there's a Studio X and many interesting emerging world cities. How do they connect? Is the fact that you have a global network really a multiplier effect? If you can share some of that.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a part of the learning curve, also setting up a space that has a presence globally. Was that, where do you stop? And I think we've stopped. There's not going to be any more spaces. But I think we found the interest in doing spaces that don't necessarily have that kind of very strong definition. So the pop-up in Shenzhen was a totally temporary space. It was about reuse, old factory, redone for a period of 2 months. That was a very successful space. The Santiago doesn't have a physical space. Santiago is just maybe like Jaaga. It's actually six people who got together and says, we're tired of just making buildings. We want to make ideas. We want to get back into that. So they work, all over the place. And every time we have a meeting in New York, there's a new person from Santiago that comes. So we don't have like one director. We just have the voice of the moment, person who has something to say. So I think that it's a challenge. I mean, I think the next steps for Studio X are really the cross-collaborative. We have done some projects. I mean, we did a project last year with Istanbul and Amman, which we tried to scale up the intervention. So there was a project that happened every summer in GSAP, which was called the Summer Workshop, in which two faculty took a group of students to the Middle East. They started in Amman 1 year, and then the next year they were in Amman again. It's all about public space projects.
Then the second year, they attached Amman and Istanbul together. And then the third year, they said, let's really go for it. Let's do Amman, Istanbul, Mumbai. So we took students from Mumbai to Istanbul. We did the public space workshop there. We took the same students from Istanbul to Mumbai. And the GSAP students as well came. So it was like this kind of caravan, a traveling series of urbanists and idea makers over a period of 3 weeks. I mean, the interesting thing at the end of the day was seeing what the capacity of the Studio X was to absorb those different ideas and then translate them culturally. And I think the thing was, there was a limit. 3 weeks of traveling and doing something in Amman that was very specific, doing something in Istanbul, and then finally coming to Mumbai, and literally, they were like blown away. I mean, for some reason, Mumbai just took them out. There was so much energy that was expended in trying to figure out what to do here. So I think those were also the limits. I mean, it's ideologically, I would say there's so much, but there are always like limitations. Even an idea can get stretched only so far before it has to get scaled up. So let's say if that idea that came out of Istanbul and Mumbai went back into the university, it would go through a different reiteration of ideating. You know, so maybe we have to pass the buck a little bit and also understand that maybe spaces like ours are incubators for something bigger that has to go somewhere else, and it has to pass through another set of spaces, you know.